Eye to Eye, a Showrunners Radio production.
Geekgasm, you know, where
geek-gasm.
I had a geekgasm.
But, you know, when the nose is just, hey, you know, just get protocol, you know, because, you said, you know, big time music aficionado. Yeah. And then now even for your text, you know, you said Morricone, and all of a sudden I say, okay, let's call it, because, you know, any of Morricone, greatest, you know, one of the greatest closing shows, famous for Sergio Leone.
You wondered why I asked, didn't
you? You find the, you know, space about Mark Kirby, you find the most film, and you might not be thinking it's about film, you might not be like, oh, it's about film, but all of a sudden it strikes me after the film. Well, I know it's a risk, it's not, doesn't have to be a Western style, but most of the iconic tracks, you know, the noise and the because he had this
I'm pretty sure they didn't go to set somebody on fire,
but I like the way he works the anyway,
Leitmotiv.
I should have said, you got me.
Leitmotiv.
The Leitmotiv. Anyway, that's what I was trying to say. But the idea that each character's got a theme.
Yeah.
And then when the character comes on, you take a what's called Zan.
What's the theme of that thing?
And you've got a Bronson character. There's a scene in that film where Claudia Cardinale arrives on the train station and she's going to talk to her husband who's been killed by her family.
Yeah.
She doesn't know at that point and she comes up the train station and there's a massive scene where, you know, the hospital goes to the train station and the porter's put on her bags and she's standing there kind of thing. As she walks through the train station doors, the camera is all one shot. It never stops. There's a single shot and it goes on. It's about 2 or 3 minutes long.
Yeah.
And it comes up and the camera comes up the top of the building. As the camera comes up the top of the building, he hits the theme for the camera, which is fantastic.
Yeah.
Best. And you've got to be like,
the music actually, you know, and like the travel that pulls you, is that like a guy, you've seen Touch of Evil, or someone else?
Yeah.
You know, that opening shot, you know, when you hear the music
like that? I'm not sure, I know the film, but I couldn't tell you.
But it's that kind of thing, what you just said about how these long travel shots, you know, that they're silent, you know, silent films, but they carry you to the scene, you know, Brian De Palma's famous film.
It's
only going to be like a 2 to 5 minute
session, right? There's so much in a film that is so visual. You often are not even aware of the sounds that are coming out of you until something grabs you, because it's a combination of the scene and the music, and then suddenly you can find yourself. You just it's like a subconscious thing. The music's going in, and you suddenly. it's just carrying you that, and that's, I mean, that's the stuff
that I'm talking about.
Do 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 do
But if you said deliverance, I remember the banjo. No, deliverance. Remember that? Was like, I think the way you play, I mean, music is integral to a lot of, as far as scores or films. Like, another one is Angelo Badalamenti, Twin Peaks. You know, I mean, when you hear Twin Peaks going on, and you know, you're set in that time and place. And I mean, believe it or not, Twin Peaks is the 80s, you know, late 80s when it first came out, you know, that score.
There's so much that sets a period in a piece of music. I remember doing a play that I was in that was in the sort of 70s, and I don't know the piece of music we used, but it was from Rocky. And what it did, it actually set the... No, it was someone singing, and it was sort of...
Singing? How can you sing that?
It was a piece from the film.
No, he's like,
Robbie Strong.
But it actually set the period.
But I will tell you though, every time I hear that Rocky score, I'm inspired. You know, I just can't help it. It has that elevated rhythm, you know, where it's the passion of it. You know, you just can't help it. You know, and when it goes into the final fight, you know, you just can't help but stand up and start shadowboxing.
Yeah.
Oh my God, that's horrible. Yeah. I think it was like the worst film ever. Yeah. Exactly what they said.
That's very nice music. I think he had to pick his theme and his goal.
That you were talking about before, how the band would play along with the film.
Yeah, because I think, well, sometimes in movie theatres, it's great to be, if you go around the old parts of Liverpool, any street, anywhere you go in Liverpool, there's an old movie theatre, and most of them are movie theatres anymore, they've become that. But you know, there's a picture palaces, the ones that are still standing.
Bingo halls.
There's quite a number of them. If they're not bingo halls, then they become all, or they become the box store, the warehouse, whatever they've become now. So think about it back in the day. They're all sort of hijacking. It would have been fabulous places. If you were going, before the tour, you would have been, sat in a van. There'd have been a guy on a piano. Maybe an old, probably a piano or something like that. What's in there? And you might have got a score. I mean, I haven't done a lot of those guys. We're sitting improvised music. And then you've got, I think Led Zeppelin's baseball. I think his father was used to sit in front of the screens and back. He used to go mapping and back as a musician, you might go. Because in those days it was all sort of like, all the acting stuff.
Still do that one.
And the other one was very, very classical hand movement. Must for art at the end of that point. It was a sort of like sort of acting style, and it just got onto the screen, and then so you'd be sort of like a swayed diminished clause, that's kind of
like a blue diamond. But you know, like it's kind of like at the Philharmonic Hall here in Liverpool, like where you would go to a show. And I remember going to a show some time ago, and I just sit in the theater, and all of a sudden the piano rises up out of the stage. And you know, the guy is on the piano, and
It's
dialogue in itself, isn't it? I remember because I do a little teach film sometimes, and I remember, you know, I was doing a class on horror, and I saw the same Friday the 13th.
Yeah.
Okay. Anyway.
Can you hear that over there?
Anyway. So it's a scene. It's one of those killing scenes. And you know, you watch it, you play it, and everybody's like, freaking out. But then I said, okay, now let's watch this again without the sound. You know, and it just was a proof of how music is so important. But it also was showing that, like, as few filmmakers that, you know, look, you say, everybody said, hey, what kind of film you want to make? Like, I want to make a horror, and it's because they want all of those elements.
Yeah.
But when they ask you on set, you don't have those elements. You know, the girls just walk up and wood. You know, cameraman, you know, they're trying to stop a flagging. So it's just kind of like, you know, so you don't need the same element, but when you put it together, the music has to find what they have in the company, the key to make it film. I mean, you know, when you agree to that, though, it's
awesome.
The music is just the ultimate, you know, of language.
You can watch through the brushes of film, I've even seen film clips recently where they've taken actual any Foley editing. There's no
video.
You know, they've just had music and they've had a sound that's completely silent. A picture, if you like, the only music to describe. I think it's just seen really recently. It's kind of like mountain
album.
With
the wolf.
I didn't know which film it was actually. I just saw the music. And so I didn't know it was an actual.
Yeah, it was the wolf. Yeah.
Okay, so let's see. I'll describe the film, you tell me what it is.
I will.
What I was going to say is, I've got my name for it. The guys who were writing the same days in the 1890s were throwing this kind of just becoming big authors. They were simply, they were the concept of a musician in those days, a composing musician, to go down, to go on a holiday in a beach, in other words, to go on location. I'd sit there with a sketch pad and draw the sketch pad and then write out what it would be in terms of a probably a photograph. Yeah, well, no, I mean, write it out, sketches, a sea sketch, and then you've written, what's happening, what's like in the clouds. In a way, they're basically writing a film script, and then they put the music. So what they, in other words, they set themselves a program out, and they write the symphony in four movements, in four sections. That was essentially a film. The only thing about it, I was giving an example of a bit like Russian poetry, Rachmaninoff, his story that was like, I don't think it would have been a box office hit, I'm afraid it was something like, it was the sea, it's a bit majestic, isn't it? Then there's a storm, and at the end of it, the storm goes, and the car returns. And that's the symphony, and that's so good. Now that probably sounds good, but I'm not sure anyone's going to go and watch it.
I was wondering whether they were talking about synesthesia. It's like singing music as colours, or it's how people
synesthesia
conceptualize them. It's like we are. How people conceptualize either or it's a mixing of the senses, really. It's where you actually see music as colours, or you can actually see an image and relate it to music, or
instead of you pontificating on substitution, right? If you were to do a score or something, what would be your kind of mentality around creating the right score for a particular piece?
As a piece of film, and then I go home and I go, I put some music for this, and I just look until something appears. I go, I'm going to get an electric razor, and I'm going to get a guitar thing in my neck, and I'm going to go like this, and I'm going to run the electric razor near the guitar, and I'm just going to go, and make these kind of abstract noises that I could have, and then I put it to the film, and I go, that works, so it doesn't work, and then, I'd be more experimental about it, Philip Glass or something like that. It's just fascinating. That's actually like looking at like a summer color.
There are some stars in this. There's actually songs into a film. But most of it, accentuate the film, you're using noises. It's like the noise music. You're making noise music, but then you're actually bringing it in.
Isn't that the non-diegetic?
I'd like to admit that, I don't know what non-diegetic means.
It's
non-diegetic.
Yes. I'm not sure where I stand on the idea of putting songs in films. To me, that seems like something you're doing wrong.
Definitely. It's always kind of like the latest teeny popular song, by an artist who's a one-hit wonder, sitting about love, and it's always going to be in some kind of rom-com, or TV, show. That is really popular, especially in the 90s, like Dawson's Creek or Fantasy. It'll be some song that you say, oh, this is really nice, I'm a popular artist, but it just works.
Less than a minute. I'm contradicting myself. somewhere. It's got a little flex on the first time I saw the face of the main person. Fantastic, it's a fantastic version, and it fits great in the film, so we can do it.
Organically,
offensive
sound.
Do you like that?
Offensive sound?
That way, they can
But if there's a shot coming up, you've got to know there's a shot coming up so you can get the drop on to it.
Well, because it's kind of like I am the camera, like you can just feel that this shot is going on too long. So that means you would actually be looking at the editing of the camera.
I think it's
about that tension and pace, isn't it? You know, like if you're going to score, you can't score the data.
If you start to prepare, then you lose the improvisational thing. I suppose I'm looking for a position point of view. Just have to jam to something that you didn't know
was going
to happen, just to see what
happened. Yeah, I do.
Anyway, we're playing, that was the evergreen kind of stands and watches the back. It doesn't matter what you do, and you sort of say, you might as well either stop playing. So what we did is we play along with some kind of tunes and we create music. So suddenly, like, we're pretend this is an evergreen, it probably stands and watches, I guess, and we're like, we can. And he misses, like, duh. And you went, your head's a high. So, I mean, obviously, we don't know what we're going to
do.
But it's great that I think you can do something similar. You don't really know what's going to happen. You've got to watch it. But I think, you're right, it's a shock. It's like a sudden real snap. I didn't like that.
What I'm saying is, it would get the most out of the music, and it triggers ideas in the music that you wouldn't normally have. And I think that's good.
It also gives the opportunity to turn a thriller into a thriller when you get the going.
Which
might
be
a
comedy,
I mean, that's just a guaranteed way to get a comedy. If you took a Simon movie,
It wasn't the original music, it was just someone had an idea. I heard this. let's do this.
Yeah, well, see, that's the whole thing. A lot of that is secrets, you know? I mean, like you just said about Carpenter, you know, because he's a synthesizer man, you know, either he planned that out or that just happened. But we do know, like, what the, you know, all the time does. You know, hey, we need something to say this. You know, now, it's not like you can go out and say, okay, I'm going to go and get us a musician like him, and I need to be protected. You're too busy out trying to make it work. You know, and so your focus should be that. It shouldn't be about, okay, what crazy music you're gonna give me that could be a time.
I'll tell you what, Tom Gallus did the music to
Charity of
Pride. And that, it was out of the music, but it was the right music for the film.
Well, I mean, but see, I mean, that's where I think is, man. And you know, you just look at that opening shot of the one thing. You know, I'm pretty sure Vangelis is something that happened just okay, now what's it?
I mean, the thing about Vangelis is he was a synthesizer guy. That's cool. That's what we do. So it might be that that would be the natural thing if he's my huge champ. He washes it on and doing that.
I don't think it went that way around. I think someone heard Vangelis and said, I know, I really like this and we're going to use this. We're going for this because it just fits it. You know, although it's out of the period, you know, they didn't have sense then. So, which you think, oh, that's a totally not even that. But it fitted so well that it made the movie.
Actually, I don't remember any other part of the movie except for that.
Yeah.
I would agree with you that it probably came up out of the last minute. Like, you know, what can we do, man? This is pretty boring.
Anyway, that's good.
good at that. You know, we, you know.
Yeah, I mean, Chopin.
Chopin's all in over the place. I probably should do this.
I
know all the
people
in French are going to publish it. It's the same with it, isn't it?
I can speak it.
Well, anyway,
I know a few people who work off Chopin.
Anyway, we'd like to thank, you know, Paul Capper, the captain, for showing up here beside the Italian Cafe. We came for the coffee at the Italian Club on Bowl Street and everything. Next time you come here, we will not be in the bathroom. I'd like to thank Paul, and of course, Noel, you know, funny as usual, with a grasp of knowledge.
I'm just too, that's the joke.
Somebody has it.